Siddhanta Sarshati Goshami Raj Prabhupada. Ananta Koti Vaishnavrindaki. Nama Charja Srila Haridas Thakur. Prem Sukaho Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar. Shri Vasari Gaur Bhakta Vrindaki. Sri Sri Radha Krishna Gop Gopinath Sham Puradha Kumigiri Govardhanaki. Vrindavan Tham Ki. Pradip Tham Ki. Jagannath Puri Ki. Ganga Mayi ki
jai,
Jamuna Mayi ki
jai,
Tulsi Devi ki
jai,
Bhakti Devi ki
jai,
Samaveda Bhakti Vrinda ki
jai.
All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories to the assembled
devotees.
All glories to the assembled
devotees.
Go Premanande.
Thank you all very much for coming. This is Bhagavad Gita as it is. Chapter 9, text 3. Ashradhana purusha dharma syasya parantapa akapyamam nivartante mrityu samsara vartmani. Oh, I forgot to suggest that those with children might want to sit toward the back because that provides an easier way for an alternative program. You might even find that upstairs is better for you because there you don't have a mean, nasty speaker who complains about children.
There's a creche upstairs. Yeah, there's a creche upstairs. In the
how much could you ask?
You can listen to the class as well and thank you.
Creche up. Those who are not faithful in this devotional service cannot attain me, O conqueror of enemies. Therefore they return to the path of birth and death in this material world. The faithless cannot accomplish this process of devotional service. That is the purport of this verse. Faith is created by association with devotees. Unfortunate people, even after hearing all the evidence of Vedic literature from great personalities, still have no faith in God. They're hesitant and cannot stay fixed in the devotional service of the Lord. Thus, faith is the most important factor for progress in Krishna consciousness. In the Chaitanya Charitamrita, it is said that faith is the complete conviction that simply by serving the Supreme Lord, Sri Krishna, one can achieve all perfection. That is called real faith. As stated in the Srimad Bhagavatam, Yataturor Mulam Shechanena Shrityanti Tatskanta Putropashaka Pranopaharaj Chayatendriyanam Tathaiva Sarvar Hanamachuteja. By giving water to the root of a tree, one satisfies its branches, twigs, and leaves. And by supplying food to the stomach, one satisfies all the senses of the body. Similarly, by engaging in the transcendental service of the Supreme Lord, one automatically satisfies all the demigods and all other living entities. Therefore, after reading Bhagavad Gita, one should promptly come to the conclusion of Bhagavad Gita. One should give up all other engagements and adopt the service of the Supreme Lord, Krishna, the personality of Godhead. If one is convinced of this philosophy of life, that is called faith. Om Gyan Kimiran Tasya Ganandana Shalakaya Chatur Nidita Mina Asmai Shri Gurave Namaha Shri Chaitanya Mahavishtam Sthapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Padamayam Tathati Shapadantikam Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Jata Padakamam, Shri Gurum Vaishnavamsa, Shri Rupam Sagrashatam, Sahagana Raghunathan Vitanam Stam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadhutam Purushatam Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Sri Radha Krishna Padam Sahagana Lalita Sri Visakhan Vitam Shat Hey Krishna, Karuna Sindho, Dina Bandho Jagatpate, Gopesha Gopika Kanta, Radha Kanta Namostute, Tata Kaushana Gaurangi, Radhe Vrindavaneshwari, Vrishabhanusse Devi, Pranami Hari Priye, Vancha Kopadrubhyascha Kripa Sindho Yadevacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadhar Sri Vasadi Gaura Bhaktavrinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare Ashwamithana Purusha Dharmasyasya Padantapa Apraptya Maam Nivartante Mrityu Samsara Vartmani. Would you like a scene? Can you find one? This faith in Krishna, people think that faith is a sentimental thing to religious people. But everybody has some faith. You give, say, 80 or 100 or 1,000 pounds to a lady standing behind a counter, and she tells you that you'll be able to get on an airplane. Maybe she gives you a slip of paper, which is kind of a promise, or maybe she just gives you a number. Little six-digit number. You paid 800 pounds and you got a number. And still you have faith that you're going to get on an airplane and then you're going to go to India or America or wherever it is. It's faith. That's all it is. You put your money in the bank. You have faith you'll get it back. Maybe even with interest. I don't know how, even do people still go to barber shops? I don't know, I haven't been to one in 50 years. But at least they're barber chairs, at least old style barber chairs. At least in the Western movies, they're the old style barber chairs, and the barber's there. And he's got a great big razor, and you put your head back like this, and he stands over your throat with the razor. Faith. Or you go into a hospital and they knock you out and then they stand over you with knives and other instruments of torture and you don't know what they're going to do to you. But you have faith that they're going to do something reasonable at least, maybe even helpful. You certainly have faith that they're going to take a lot of your money. Of course, in this, at least in America, oh my goodness, that much we know. You can't actually take a step forward without faith. You all walked up the stairs here with faith in the stairs. that could have all collapsed right under you. You don't know. Maybe you'll be more cautious now walking down. But we have faith. Your wife or your mother or your friend put some food on the table in front of you, and you actually eat it. You don't know what they put in it. Could have put anything in there. But as an act of faith at the very least, not only faith, but strong faith, you're convinced that my mother wouldn't poison me. Even my wife wouldn't poison me. You have faith. Hundreds of people walk into the restaurant downstairs. They don't think we're going to poison them either. They don't know. But they have faith. Everyone's operating on faith. Everyone. So here, faith in Krishna. Generally, we're acting on, we have faith in our government. We have faith in our own strength. We have faith in our own intelligence. That's kind of wild. How reliable is my intelligence? How reliable is my strength? How strong is my government? In the Srimad Bhagavatam it said, Deha pacha kalatradishu atmasanyesha satspapi teshu pramukta mitana pashanapi vipashati. Deha means this body. We think that we'll protect ourselves by our physical strength, or by the strength of our family, or my family will protect me. Or kalatra, my wife will take care of me. And so on. My country will take care of me, my friends will take care of me. Atma sainyeshu, these are like my army. Asatsvapi, but they're all fallible. My wife is not free from the powers of death. My friends are not free. My families are not free. My government, there's no one in my government that's free from the power of death. We see that all around us people are dying day after day. Then how will they protect me from death? This body. I'll go to the gym. I'll stay strong. I'll practice Tai Chi, martial arts. You practice your martial arts and you become strong and powerful and get run over by a lorry. What is your power? Teshu pramatta nitana. Therefore, the Bhagavatam says, this is madness. Pashyanapi na pashyati. We're seeing all around us that everyone has to die, and we're not thinking, I'll have to die also. Yeah, theoretically, maybe, but not actually. I don't take it that I'll actually have to die, and I'll have to do something about that. If they were going to evict me from my apartment, I would immediately, I'd be calling lawyers, I'd be calling the city, I'd be doing something. But I'm going to get evicted from this body, and I don't take it seriously. Or I take it very seriously, I call up the doctor. What will the doctor do? He has to die also. No one is free from the clutches of death. Jatasthihi dhruvomrityu. For one who is born, Krishna says, death is certain, 100%. If you want faith in something, here's faith. Everyone who was born has to die. Law of nature. And dhruvam janma mrtasya janma. This we don't know, but for one who dies, birth is equally certain. Maybe we have the understanding that for one who's born, death is certain. But Krishna says, for one who dies, birth is certain also. Because I'm not this body. And when the body dies, it doesn't mean that I die. But I have to come back in another body. Just if I leave this room, I don't suddenly dissolve. I have to go to another room, another place. So when I leave this body, then the next body is there. But for one who dies, birth is certain. Therefore, one should not be, one should be mindful of this. That where will I go? And what is my purpose while I'm here? Do I like this business of birth and death? Am I simply meant to go around and round in that circle? Is that my fate? And Krishna says, for one who understands him, janma karma cha me divyam evam yo veti tatvata tattva deham puna janma naiti mami. One has to understand Krishna factually. Krishna is not simply a superficial idea or myth or anything of that sort. Krishna means the original personality of Godhead. And if one understands that personality of Godhead factually, not superficially, in fact, Chakva deham punarjanma naiti. Upon leaving this body, he doesn't have to take another body. Mami. He goes back to Krishna. As I'm a person and you're a person, Krishna is also a person. As I have some place to live, you have some place, he has his place. But he's the supreme person, so he has the supreme place. And you can go there, I can go there, everyone can go there. These facts are attested by Krishna himself and by the great self-realized souls. So, you can accept it or not. We can all accept it or not. That's up to us. But if we don't accept it, what is so what? If I don't, you accept it, but if I don't accept it, so what? Everybody has his own idea. You believe this, I believe that. So if I don't accept it, so what? Then Krishna says, so what? Ashradhana purusha. Dharmasyasya paramita. If one doesn't have faith in the process of spiritual realization, the process of Krishna consciousness, the science of spiritual understanding stated here in Bhagavad Gita, apapyamam. Krishna says, he doesn't attain me. That makes sense. If you don't think about Krishna, you won't reach Krishna. You're not interested in Krishna, you won't reach Krishna. You're not interested in a PhD, you're not going to earn a PhD. That's just common sense. So we won't attain Krishna. So what's the loss? Aprapyamam nivartam te mrityut samsara. If I don't attain Krishna, where will I go? I'll continue in this cycle of birth and death. That's a fact. That's a fact. Because this material world is set up in such a way as to be unlimitedly entangling. as long as I'm trying to enjoy the resources of the material energy, I'll have to come back again and again and continue to try to enjoy the resources of material energy. This fact is explained in Bhagavad Gita in quite some length. It's not simply catechism or dogma that, yes, I believe that I'll come back again and again. I believe. But Krishna explains everything rationally, philosophically, probably would say scientifically, sensibly. So that a thoughtful person will grasp this understanding that this one life is not everything. That this short lifetime is not everything. Otherwise, why are people born into different circumstances? Why is one person born rich, another person is born poor? One person is born in America, another person is born in China. Of course, you say, well, it's chance, and it's, but chance means nothing. When we say that something happens by chance, what we mean is we don't know how it happens. Chance, there is no such thing as chance, as a cause for something. You didn't come by chance, you came for some reason. Even if you were walking by and suddenly you thought, well, let me go see, that's also not chance. There's a whole background of your whole life by which you thought, well, all right, let me, first of all, what were you doing here? That was not just chance, some reason. Either you got a phone call and you thought you were supposed to go there, and actually it wasn't true, but somehow or other. There's a history. There's not just chance. There are reasons for everything. And then every reason has a reason behind it, and every reason has another reason. But nothing just happens. Nothing just happens. That's all. That's like mysticism, that things just happen. That's like people have problems with religion. Let's talk about that. Things just happen with no reason, by something called chance, which is just nothing. One mathematician explained to me that chance is a description that you make after an event. You know, when there's like 1,000 events that happen, and you want, then you can describe them by something called chance. You say there's a 50-50 chance, but that's not an explanation of why one coin or two coins or any number of coins turned up heads rather than tails. It's just a mathematical description of what happened. You know, after 50% came up this way and 50% came up that way, you say there's a 50-50 chance after 10,000 tries. But nothing in nature makes it happen, makes any one coin come up this way, that way, because of some law called the law of chance. Anyway, that's about as much as I understood of what the mathematician told me. Math was never my strong point. But a little stronger point, at least I can understand, everything has a reason for happening. I may know the reason, I may not know the reason, I may understand, I may not understand. But there's a reason. There's a reason everyone's taken birth in a particular place, in a particular circumstance. And Krishna gives that reason in the Bhagavad Gita, because of our past activities. Because of our past activities, now I've come back this way, he's come back that way, she's come back this way. People downstairs have come back that way. God bless him. Who knows which way they'll come back next time. But by Krishna consciousness, chatva deham punarjanmanayati, this business of birth and death can be finished because we'll go back to Krishna by Krishna consciousness. These people have come here because of, they've cultivated a particular kind of consciousness. Right? That's why they're there. And so that consciousness has attracted them to this particular place at this particular time. So consciousness also attracts us to the next body. And consciousness of Krishna will attract us to Krishna. And by that strong attraction, reciprocated by Krishna, because Krishna becomes attracted by the devotee who is attracted to him, one goes back to Krishna. And that's our purpose. This understanding, this conviction, comes by association. If we associate with those who are associated with Krishna, then this strong understanding will grow. Just as we get an understanding of economics by associating with those who are into economics, we get an understanding of chemistry or physics by that association. We'll get an understanding and a taste for Krishna by the association of the devotees of Krishna. And in that association, we can chant Hare Krishna, we can serve Krishna, and our life will be nice. Maybe I'll stop there and see what kind of questions you have. If any, yes?
So the soul doesn't have a beginning, doesn't have an end. We at some point fight for or struggle to understand that this end, we leave our body or we leave our bodily activities so the soul can go back where it belongs. Mm. Okay, my question is, how then did it end up getting a body in the first place? I mean, if it's not that you have fallen from...
Yeah, how we get here is a great topic. The summary of that topic is by forgetting Krishna.
Okay, but if the soul is...
is with Krishna, how does he forget Krishna?
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm.
By his misuse of free choice.
Misuse of free choice?
Free choice. Everyone has freedom. Because Krishna is completely free, and we're parts of Krishna, we have a little freedom.
Even within Krishna?
Everyone has a little freedom. Because you're part of Krishna, Krishna is completely free. So you get a little freedom also. And when we misuse that freedom, we turn away from Krishna. Then at once fallen. Why should we turn away from Krishna? No good reason. There's something with no good reason. Everything has a cause, but that has no sensible cause.
So the process would be then at first point...
You practically can't get a first point, but okay.
Right, because then you think, okay, the promise is that if I do this, then I'll go back and I'll never come back here. Mm. And then I will
be... But you're worried that, well, if I fell from there, what if I do go back there, and then maybe I'll fall again.
Uh-huh.
But Krishna is the person in charge. He says, don't worry about it.
Okay.
It'll be okay. Or if you're going to worry about it, first go there and then worry about it.
Okay. It's a good one.
Yes.
Maharaj, you just mentioned that when we die, our next body is almost or decided what body we are taking. But... it doesn't happen if that person is guaranteed to go back to Godhead. Is it right?
Yeah, if you're meant to go back to Godhead, back to Krishna, then there's no body. If you're meant to be liberated from the jail, then there's no cell reserved for you anymore. You become a free man. So those who are going back to Krishna, they have no need of having another body in the material world. Okay?
Yes, thank you.
Yes? Is that a question right in the back? No, it's just... Yes?
Maharaj, you talking about faith, and my faith in Krishna...
I have a question. Was there once upon a time a second microphone here? Is it still here?
Today
it's out on the... It's out there on one of our many festivals. Okay, so today is official London Speak Loud Day.
Maharaj, basically, my faith in Krishna would increase if I could understand how Krishna, and how the Supreme Personality of Godhead is humble. I don't understand that. I mean,
your faith would increase if you could understand how Krishna is humble. Okay. In the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, Brahma Sutra Padais about better. In the Bhagavad Gita, Arjuna is saying, Raneas Tapya Mechuta. My dear Krishna, please pull the chariots between the armies. And Krishna does it. Now, Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead, he's the controller of all the universes. He's the source of all the demigods. He's the ultimate possessor of all opulences. And he's acting as the charioteer for Arjuna. Is that not humble? The charioteer is not the big shot. The charioteer is basically an ancient taxi driver.
I mean, someone would say
something like that. No, he's your driver. The driver is, to be a driver is not a very ultra-prestigious position. You're the driver. The person who's the passenger or the person who's the warrior on the chariot, he's the man. And the person who's pulling the chariot, he's in a very humble position. And Krishna is accepting that position to serve his devotee Arjuna. Isn't that humble?
Someone would say that you would expect something more from that, because we could do that. We could be a chariot driver. Then Krishna is,
you could be, because what are you now? You know, maybe you're, I don't know, what do you do?
I'm a teacher.
You're a teacher. So to go from teacher to driving a car or a chariot is not such a step down compared to being the lord of all the worlds.
Say, Maharaj, it doesn't touch me.
Well, what can I say? That's because you're only a teacher.
I mean,
what else does Krishna have to do to be humble? He's the lord of everything, and he becomes a charioteer for his devotee. Or, he has a friend, Sudama Brahmana. And when his friend comes to visit him, Krishna at this time is king of Dwarka. Dwarka is a huge city with thousands of palaces and servants and opulence and you name it. And Krishna is the king of all this. And he, in his childhood, he had a friend named Sudama, who was a very simple Brahmin. But they went to school together. Brahmin means like a son of an intellectual family, but poor. The Brahmins were voluntarily poor. They prefer to be simple and poor than rich and entangled. So this Brahmin friend comes to see Krishna, and Krishna gets down from his throne and puts Sudama on his throne and honors him by washing his feet and giving him such a reception. Is that humble?
It's nothing extraordinary.
It's nothing extraordinary. Happens every day here. Queen Elizabeth's old friends from school drop by. And she gets down from her throne and says, "Oh, no, you please sit here. And let me wash your feet besides." It happens all the time, right? Nothing extraordinary.
I mean, I'm sure in history...
Times has stopped reporting it. It's so common.
I'm sure in history a king could have done that.
A king could have done that in history. And would that king have been considered a pretty humble king?
Yes, he'd be considered humble. But we expect something more from the Supreme Personality.
All right, you tell me. What do you expect? What do you want? What do you have? What does he have to do to pass your test?
Wash his feet.
Maharaj, you obviously know more about Krishna than I do. That's why I'm asking you the question.
No, but I'm telling you, but you want something more. You know, if he becomes the charioteer of Arjuna, well, everybody becomes, you know, drives somebody somewhere. If he gets down from his throne and washes the feet of Sudama Brahm, well, that's a sort of prosaic, everyday affair. So you tell me, what does he have to do to be humble?
Well, I mean, something supremely.
Tell me.
Yeah.
Tell me what your standard of it is. I mean, what does God have to do to satisfy you?
Something personal, something that will touch.
Personal? Sudama is a person, Krishna is a person, that seems very personal to me.
It's personal to Sudama, but not to me.
What does he have to do? Bow down to you and say, please, please? Even that, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he is Krishna. He is the most exalted person. And he comes to this world accepting the role of a devotee, and he has a beautiful wife, devoted wife, and a very devoted mother, and he leaves home and becomes a renounced beggar to bring people like you and me back to Godhead. He sleeps on stone floors and he undergoes every kind of deprivation. Although he's the lord of everything, or even in the material world, he's very nicely situated. Is that humble? That's humble.
Wow. Hare Krishna, thank you very much. Who else has a humble question?
If, as you say, and as scripture says, that Krishna is the controller of the soul.
Or say again? It's speak loud day. We really have to be loud.
Yes. As you say, the Krishna, Lord Krishna, is the controller of each and every person's soul.
Yes.
Yeah. Then how soul is affected by the karma of the body?
How is the soul attracted by the karma of the body when Krishna himself is the controller of the soul? The controller gives you a little freedom. He doesn't want to be absolutely dictatorial. No, you have some freedom also. And most living beings never misuse that freedom. Therefore they stay in the spiritual world. A small number of us misuse it, and here we are. Okay. Yes.
In the purport, you read that faith is the conviction that simply by serving Krishna, one can achieve all perfection. So my question is, how do we check our own progress against conviction?
How do we check our own progress in that conviction? Is that your question?
Yeah.
That is, how do you know how much faith you have? By your own actions? Do you actually depend on Krishna's mercy? Do you actually depend on, even practically, the spiritual master instructs, chant Hare Krishna 16 rounds a day, follow these principles. Read, chant, we'll make progress. Do we do that? Or do we think, well, I don't know, you know, I mean, he said.
I think sometimes we have more, sometimes
we
have less.
No, sometimes we have more, sometimes we have less. But the more you have faith in the process, the more you'll be enthusiastic about the process.
As it goes up and down, how do you know you're making progress?
The less it goes up and down, the more you know you're making progress. You experience subjectively. You yourself can see how I'm becoming strong in Krishna consciousness. or how I'm feeling. Sometimes up, sometimes down. You can see that for yourself. Bhaktivinoda Thakur recommends that you regularly see how you're doing. Everyone else can see, you can see something.
Like in answer to the question you were just asking, but everyday life is a test to show you whether you're progressing.
Yeah. In your practical life, you'll see what kind of progress is there. Or maybe you won't see, but after a year you look back and you see how much progress you made. Someone takes to the process and not quite sure, they're wondering, sometimes doing, sometimes not doing, but they're okay, mostly doing. And after a year they look back and, you know, I was way back here and now I'm way up here. And their faith grows, so it made progress.
Maybe if I rephrase it.
Go ahead.
How do you know how far we have to go?
How do you know how far you have to go? Well, the devotee always thinks he has very far to go. The more he thinks that, the closer he is. If I think, well, I don't have very far to go, I'm 95% perfect. A few more points and I'll be there. Then I'm in problems. The more I think that I have so far to go, the closer I get.
Maharaj, the question is, if the soul goes to the spiritual world, to Lord Krishna, can the soul perform again wrong thing so that they are sent back?
No, you can. Can the soul in the spiritual world misuse his independence? He can, but he doesn't.
So I think it does, because the population in the world is only increasing.
Oh, population! Forget the population world. You don't. You have no idea of the population of the world. What's the population of London?
It's increasing.
What's the population of London?
10 million.
10 million. Is that about right? Would you say?
No, it's not right. It's not right.
Well, what's the actual population of London?
It should be less than that.
Less than 10 million. Okay. In your estimation, the population of London is less than 10 million. How many of them are ants? How many of them are trees? How many of them are viruses? How many of them are mosquitoes? How many of them are fish? You're counting the population by your little sliver, and you say the population is increasing. You're not looking at anything. You're just looking at a little small portion of the population. You're saying, well, there's more people in London, so the population is increasing. You don't know what the population is. Actually, the population, there's infinite number of living beings. You can never count them. And even in this material world or this one planet, you could never count how many living beings there are. And this one universe with as many living beings as there are in it is only one out of millions of universes. And Chaitanya Charitamrita said it's like one mustard seed in a bag of mustard seeds. You all see mustard seeds from time to time? Little. It's like a... I don't know what to compare a mustard seed to. It's so small. But in a whole bag of mustard seeds, what's one mustard seed? And this one universe is like a mustard seed amidst all the universes. So, and we're counting the population and saying, well, I don't know because the population is increasing. Anyway, this is our program for decreasing the population. Send as many people back to God as possible.
Maharaja, faith is very important, but intelligence says one thing and mind always seems to be dominating. And when mind is dominating the intelligence, faith decreases. How can we increase faith?
By intelligence. If mind dominates your intelligence, then your faith decreases. So why should your intelligence be dominated by a stupid thing like the mind? Your mind should be dominated by an intelligent thing like your intelligence. And your intelligence should take guidance from the Supreme Intelligence, that's Krishna. Then your faith will grow. Thank you all very much. Hare Krishna.
Thank you.